Back with me this morning from Strategic Minerals is John Peters. John, good morning.
Good day to you, Andrew.
Good to see you, John. You've had this economics update out this week on Leigh Creek. It looks like a fair bit of work's gone into this report, John.
Yeah, look, it's, you know, people don't see what goes on in the background with a lot of this and they think that we're just sitting there. But the truth of fact is we've looked at this very closely. We've redesigned how elements of it will come as part of some of the people's inquiries about co-funding with us. We've actually gone back over and had a report produced by PPM, used to operate the place, on what the likely costs are going to the second deposit, Lynda, Lorna Doone. Now, I might just take a step back and say to people that essentially we tend to use a little jargon in here about the project, and to put it in perspective, we have a operating site, a plant at a place called Mountain of Light, which is in Leigh Creek. About 500 metres from it is a deposit which we haven't tapped yet, which is called Paltridge North. Now, that's the one that we've got the pepper in with the state government, is because every time you start a new one, you've got to get a new pepper just for the environment protection and all of that. That's what we're doing at the moment. Then about 75 kilometres away is another very well-identified JORC'd resource at, it's a twin one virtually, Lynda, Lorna Doone. And that's about 50% greater than the Paltridge North one. But of course, isn't as close to the material, to the processing plant, etc. And so our process has always been that we're going to first tap Paltridge North, produce a bit of extra cash, and then relocate up to Lynda, Lorna Doone. However, when we got the PPM report back, we realised that the costs we'd allow for relocating were about the same as if we actually rebuilt at Lynda, Lorna Doone. Now, that's pretty important, because what that meant was we didn't have to wait till we stopped processing it at Mountain of Light, dismantle part of the equipment and take it up there, but instead could build earlier and therefore could bring forward the cash flows from that. And of course, as I mentioned, that's an even larger group of deposits, and therefore so it's a lot more money. So that timing was pretty crucial as far as profitability is concerned. And then what we did have after that also is we also worked on just a little bit of shifting of the original Paltridge North schedule to move it forward a month or so. Why that's important is it reduces the capital cost. A lot of the capital cost of funding that we required at the start actually relates to the overburden at Paltridge North. And so by bringing that cash flow forward a month, we've actually been able to reduce what that need. Overall, we also then readdressed the thought of, do we actually mine the material ourselves? In our original analysis, we had it that we would be buying the equipment and mining it, and that would reduce our overall operating costs. What we've realized is that the profitability of this is such, we're probably better off actually shifting that around, maybe wearing a little bit extra operating cost, but also not requiring as much capital. So that's made a pretty big dent. To reduce it down to $2.2 million US dollars makes it a hell of a lot more accessible around the place. Now, as it's turned out, we haven't actually had to sacrifice as profitability, because by changing the way we've got our timing on the other things and by reviewing some of the aspects that we'd been, let's say, over-conservative rather than just conservative on, we've been able to do that. Now, those reassessments have been made in light of what our operations actually were when we were operating the place. So we haven't gone silly on this, et cetera, but what it basically has meant is we've ended up with a much lower capital requirement and also an improved, I think it's about 16% increase on our expected profitability. So it's a pretty sweet place that we've got ourselves into.
Just on the, John, just on the pepper for Paltridge North, have you got a time frame on when you might hear back on that?
Look, I'm actually expecting within the next couple of weeks to get some feedback on that. What the process is, we've now gone to the formal part. We get a formal feedback from the government. We've got to address that. And then we go on to the thing. Look, at the moment, we're still planning that early next year, maybe mid, or maybe the beginning of the second quarter, whatever it might be, around that time is when we're sort of our internal plans are for a movement to start work. We believe that with the lower capital cost, et cetera, the funding of this is now a hell of a lot better. Now, in particular, we actually mentioned something in the RNS that came out as part of our discussions with people. A few of the people we talked to about joint venturing approached us about whether, in fact, we'd consider listing LCCM on the ASX, on the Australian Stock Exchange. And we went down the route. We actually spoke to some brokers, which we have done. They're giving us feedback saying that we could, that it's a size that would easily go onto the exchange, that they wouldn't have a problem with it. And of course, that opens two questions to us, whether in fact we want to do that ourselves to raise funding, or whether we want to bring in a party maybe on a pre-IPO basis to do that. And we've had a few parties express interest in that already. Again, as you very quite rightly put your finger on it, most of those will wait until we got the pepper out. Okay, so getting the pepper out over the next, you know, whatever it might be. And unfortunately, I can't be specific because you're dealing with governments and who knows what the time will be. But our expectation is in the next couple of months, we'll have the pepper out and then we'll go into the other side. And as I said, we've got a lot of interest from people, particularly at the current copper price.
Well, just on, I'll come back to the copper price in a moment, John, but should Leigh Creek be spun out into a separate vehicle, what would that mean for your investors and SML?
Well, it's no real change, really, because all it is you're just taking an asset of ours and putting in another vehicle, and probably where we might dilute by a joint venture, we might dilute by shareholders in the other asset. The other side of it is that if you did go down that route, of course, it would probably provide the company greater flexibility to move in and out of the asset as they preferred. So please don't, this isn't a fait accompli, but what it's doing is it's saying that here are a number of funding options we now have to get this done. This will get done. What we're waiting on, until we get the approval from the PEPA, that's fine. After that happens, this will get done.
And you touched on it there, John. Of course, the copper price has moved up a bit quite nicely to coincide with the timing of this report here.
Well, we've actually, if you note, the report's actually based off a $3 a pound copper price, which is what we've held the whole time. It's currently about $3.15. The other thing which one needs to take into consideration when they look at this project is that it's not only the copper price, but also the Australian dollar, because we raise our revenues in US dollars and we make our expense payments in Australian dollars. So as you tend to find, there tends to be a bit of a correlation between the Australian dollar and resource prices. So if the resource price goes up, the Australian dollar goes up. So effectively, our revenues go up, but so do our costs. Right. So it's a beautiful thing about this because it made this a very robust project. We actually did some sensitivity analysis on this. And the sensitivity indicates that the price of copper would have to drop to $1.25 a pound to hit break even on the project. Right. Given that we're at $3.15, I'm feeling like we have a massive buffer there, you know? And that would reflect the fact of an Australian dollar at about 50 cents, which is a bit where it's been in the past. But if resource prices dropped as much as that, I'm sure we'd be there with the Australian dollar. Now, the other side of that, of course, is that as copper prices rise, the Australian dollar tends to rise. And so we don't get as much of an impact as a straight outright increase. So I'm happy with that because the project is so profitable. And as I said, it's got a good buffer either side.
And just from the RNS, John, you're considering two options, two different types of plant here for use at Lynda Lorna Doone. Just crunching the numbers, it appears the upside on this alone is worth more than your current market cap at SML.
Yeah. Thank you for picking that up. This is the incredible position of where our share price is at the moment. If you look at this project, right at the moment, we've identified that there are two potential upside methods of processing, and it's just the Lynda Lorna Doone one we're talking about at the moment. At the moment, we're not looking to upset the apple cart as far as what we're doing with Paltridge North because we're so close. We have our offtake arrangement on the copper cement. that could also apply to Lynda, Lorna Doone, and the numbers that we've put out is all that. However, we've had PPM and others suggest to us that we also look at using an SXEW also, or alternatively produce a copper sulfate plant and produce copper sulfate. The electro winning, both of these make very large savings in the operating costs, right? But they come at a reasonably large capital price. The SXEW comes at a very high capital price, and the copper sulfate plant comes at a marginally higher capital cost. Both produce around the same result as far as the net pre-tax profits are concerned. I think it's up about 15 million US. If you allowed for after tax, that would probably come down to say 10 million US, which, as you quite rightly point out, is more than our market cap at the moment. And that's just on a variation. If you were to take the whole project together, you'd probably say that that's the project itself is at least three times our market cap. The other side of this is the important part about whether we go down the route of either one of these is we've had some talks. The SXEW approach produces copper cathode, which is more widely sold throughout the world, which is good, but it also requires the capital cost that would require us to go out and fund separately. The copper sulfate plant would actually supply domestic demand in Australia and also is not sufficiently high that we could fund it out of the Paltridge North cash flows. So that effectively means that we could do the whole lot for the US 2.2 million that we need at the front, which is a pretty strong case at the moment. So on all of this, we're actually in a position where we've got a lot of alternatives. It's very, very high. We're probably concentrating at the moment at looking at the copper sulfate plant on Lynda, Lorna Doone and see what we can do there. We're going to bring that forward so that the profitability is very strong. And as I said, you know, it does, as your comment made light of, it doesn't make any sense compared to our market cap. But unfortunately, that's something I can't control.
So what are the big next steps here for Leigh Creek? You say you need to get the environmental approvals to mine granted and then firm up the financing. Is that the next big milestone?
Those are two, and those two are probably sequential. We probably need first to get the pepper out. We have been doing the work to do the second part, but they're going to require the pepper to come out first, I believe. So I think, you know, we do have discussions with people about that. It is a possibility that it may happen before that, right? But to me, the pepper itself is the key aspect. We get that out. Once that's out, we're in a position where we can start running pretty heavily on the finance. As you said, the numbers are there. The number of alternative funding avenues we have are there. So to me, I no longer have any. When it was up at about 5 or 6 million US for funding Leigh Creek, I was a little more concerned about how we were going to get the money. Now I know we'll get the money one way or another. It's a matter of get the pepper out, get the thing started, continue the research, improve the thing. And remember this, all the stuff that we've said about upside on Leigh Creek here doesn't include the fact that Leigh Creek exists in an area where there's a lot of known copper deposits that are effectively stranded. Once we're up and operating, we'll be able to access a lot of those and do further transactions that'll improve profitability even further. So this is an asset that's going to keep giving and giving and giving.
And what about, of course, you've also got Cobra and Redmore running alongside, John. Any updates there?
Yeah, I'm glad to say that Cobra managed to survive the US elections. But it's ticking along exactly like it was before. It's doing very good levels of production. I'm very happy with what's going there. It's continuing to underwrite our operational costs. And we're actually looking forward to that moving along in the normal process. The same time, Redmore, as I've said on your last interview, we've been doing some interviews with people about joining us and moving the project forward. I've got to say I'm extremely happy with NRG Capital and their advice to us, and also my two main people, Brett Grisk and James Blight, who have fielded a number of, quite a large number of interviews that we've had, have set up data rooms, and the people that have shown a continued interest, of which there are several, are accessing that at the moment. So that's going along exactly as I expected this part of the marketing of that to be. And I expect from that, that we're going to get into a position that next year you'll see further development on Redmore with us in conjunction with some sort of a partnership.
I think you used the phrase a bit earlier, John, the incredible situation as far as the market cap. You've got to be frustrated.
Yeah. Well, extremely. And let's not forget, I mean, I've obviously had a lot of irate shareholders approach us, et cetera. And one of the things that I always do is I do always reply. But let us not forget, Peter Whale is the second largest shareholder, one of the directors. I'm the third largest shareholder. People think that for some reason we're trying to run this down, and it's ridiculous. Our interests are very much aligned with shareholders. We can't say, what I believe has happened is the market has discounted the fact whether we'll ever do anything with Redmore or we'll ever do anything with Leigh Creek. You can see that Leigh Creek is about to pop. Redmore, I believe in the next 3 to 6 months, you'll get the news about arrangements going forward with Redmore. And again, Redmore is probably, in my mind, the best project in Cornwall going around at the moment. And we see others being funded to very large degrees for what we believe are nowhere near as well-developed asset as we have at Redmore. And we're finding that feedback coming back in our interviews, right? So to me, I'm in there for the long haul. Peter's in there for the long haul. And the smart money is in there for a long haul.
Good to see you, John. Appreciate your time. Thanks very much.
Good to see you, mate. Bye-bye.